church. Nobody wants to sit up front. Welcome to our annual picnic. Sorry we're started a little late. It sounds like we all had a little bit of an obstacle or challenge trying to get here this morning. Thank you for bringing a side dish and showing up today. It's really great to be outdoors in this beautiful setting. Do we have any announcements from you all this week?
Rose,
can you do me a favor and speak to us?
Sorry.
I wanted to thank everyone who's provided items for the personal care kits for Lutheran World Relief. On Sunday, September 26th, that would be the last Sunday of the month, the Children's Sunday School class is going to start to put those kits together for us. I'm inviting all of the adults to come downstairs and help finish the project after our Sunday worship. There will be refreshments, so there'll be some socializing as well as getting those kits ready for shipment. Thank you.
We have the TV Trot sign up if you want to donate. There's still some things that need to be donated we're asking for. Also, there is on the back sheet, there's three of them, is a volunteer sheet. We do need some volunteers to man the path and also the snack table and the beverage table, drink table. So that's going to go around. And if you want to run, please sign up.
Or walk.
Or walk. Or walk. Because we also need to walk it. Kids can do the giraffe walk as well, so please just sign up. You know somebody, get them signed up.
Any other announcements?
I don't have an announcement, but I just wanted to say.
Okay, hold on now. I can't hear you. You got to talk into this. I'll bring it this far.
I just wanted to say prayers to the family and friends of Lynn Turk Wells. He passed away this past week. So,
can you add that to the prayers? Add that person to the prayers. And I want to reiterate that Cassie Kiefer's funeral will be this Saturday, starting at 11 at Messiah. And also, just let you all know that Kyle Hoffman's grandmother Peg passed this week peacefully. So we'll be adding, please add her family to your prayers. All right, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We'll just have a moment of silence. Or listening to nice kids playing on the playground. I won't ask you to stand because I know it's hard enough getting in and out of the picnic table. So we'll just do our brief order of confession and forgiveness from where we sit. And that's what you can find that on the first page of your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Amen. Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter. Sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. Bill says Noski, I'm looking for you.
Right here. Oh, I'm on the list.
Please welcome Bill Sosnowski first, who's doing our special music today. And we'll be listening. We're not expected to sing along. To us, Bill. Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and this place, for all who offer here and online their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you, Lord, Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, and have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, through suffering and rejection, you bring forth our salvation. And by the glory of the cross, you transform our lives. Grant that for the sake of the gospel, we may turn from the lure of evil, take up our cross, and follow your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Those of you who are reading, if you come up and use the microphone, please.
First reading is from Isaiah chapter 50. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with the word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backwards. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Here ends the reading.
Join me in reciting parts of Psalm 116 responsively. I love the Lord, who has heard my voice and listened to my supplication.
The Lord has been near to me whenever I called.
The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came upon me. I came to grief and sorrow. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is full of compassion.
The Lord watches over the innocent. I was brought low, and God saved me.
Turn again to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt well with you.
For you have rescued my life from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from stumbling.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord, in the land of the living.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord.
Second reading comes from James chapter 3, 1 through 12. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put its bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is a set ablaze by a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members of the world of iniquity. It stains the whole body. It sets on fire the cycle of nature and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by this human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both flesh and brackish water? and a fig tree. My brothers and sisters, yield olives or a grapevine figs. No more can salt water yield flesh. Next.
We'll just write the Alleluia verse. Alleluia.
Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 8th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in glory of his Father with the holy angels."
Praise to you, O Christ.
I'd like to invite the children to come forward. What shall we do? Steve, can you get us if we pull out one of these? No, they don't pull out. They're attached, aren't they? Oh, what should we do, guys? Steve, where can you get us? Right here? Okay. Let's go ahead and sit at this table. Can you get us there? Come on over, Peyton. You want to sit right? Can we go around the corner? Let's go around the corner. I want you guys to meet somebody.
"Hi, my name's Goliath. What's your name?" "Oh, you don't talk, do you? Okay. Well, somebody told me your name is Miles. What do you see in my mouth?" "Right, that's my tongue. And I want to tell you about some other animal tongues here at the park, because we just had a lesson about tongues. What do I use my tongue for?" "That's right, I use my tongue to lick. And I also use it to get my food, just like you do. How long do you think your tongue is?" "1 inch? 2 inches? 3 inches? How much? Guess." "3, you're right. A human tongue is 3 inches. How long do you think the giraffe tongue is, who lives here at Lake Tobias?" "Ooh, you're real close. Hold the end of that. That's how long the tongue is. Look. 21 inches long. Whoa. That's pretty long, right? And is the giraffe tongue pink like mine?" "No, it's purple black. Because the giraffe uses his tongue to pick leaves from trees, and he would get a sunburn if he had a pink tongue like mine." Guess what else? There's a woodpecker. Did you ever see a woodpecker? Guess what their tongue does? It comes out a hole through the side of their head. And it wraps around the back of their head and then up over the top like this. You know why? It helps protect their head when they go up against the tree, right? One more question. Where is my tongue attached? That's right. Oh, you taste good. You taste so good. Where's my tongue attached?
That's right. Oh, I fooled you, didn't I?
Well, guess where the anteater's tongue is attached? It's so long, it has to start all the way down here. Can you touch here? All the way down there. What if your tongue started way down there? Wouldn't that be weird? So the pangolin and the anteater has a tongue way down there. Okay, let me think one more thing. Did you know that penguins can't taste anything? And their tongues have bristles on them. Not soft. Is your tongue soft? Let me see. Let me see. Is your tongue soft? How about your tongue? Is it soft? Is it soft?
No, mine isn't.
Is it not too soft? Well, the penguin tongue is like a brush, like you brush your hair with, and that's so he can catch those fish that are swimming all around. One more thing, let me think. I have a friend who's a frog, a horned frog. He can stick his tongue out and catch food that weighs more than him. So that means if your dad was in the living room and said, "Can you bring me something from the refrigerator?" He could sit on the sofa, stick his tongue out, and pull the refrigerator to him. That's amazing, right? Okay. I think that's all my tongue stories. Do you have any? Let me see you stick out your tongue as far as you can. Let me see, Peyton. All right, good job. All right, well, let's pray together. I'm going to put my paws together. You put your hands together, okay? And we'll pray. Ready? Dear Lord, and you say the words after me. Dear Lord, thank you for my tongue. It helps me eat and speak and blow raspberries. We love you, Lord. Amen. Can you give me a high five on the way out? Thank you. As usual, the readings seem convoluted and not like they necessarily go together. But upon closer look, we see that they do, in an odd sort of way. Those who would venture to teach have something in common with those who would venture to use their tongues. Apparently, both can either do help or do harm. When Jesus asks his disciples a pointed question, they say exactly what's on their minds. They tell what they've heard and come to believe. But then Jesus tells them to keep it to themselves. In a world where everyone has an opinion and feels entitled to it, how are we to know what ought to be shared broadly for the purpose of teaching versus what might do harm? According to 2 Timothy chapter 3,
Verse 16, only every word of Scripture is suitable for teaching, not every word that comes from the human mouth or brain. According to the book of Isaiah, a teacher's aim is to sustain the weary with a word. Well, that sounds like encouragement to me. Unfortunately, encouragement in today's world isn't all that encouraging. More often than not, encouragement seems to come through negative terms rather than positive. The weary are sustained by railing against others, by talking about their failings, quoting anyone who says the wrong thing. That doesn't teach. It stirs up disgrace. If we aim to teach, the Bible says a teacher must deliver from disgrace. The disciples are told to be quiet because what they have to say in the form of repeating what they've heard or by sharing their opinion, even though Jesus asked for it, may threaten to distract from, to disagree with, and possibly deter God's plan. Because God's plan is not the same as people's agenda. God came up with the notion of grace, something generous, undeserved, free, and unexpected, that comes only from God. People can show grace, but only God can give it. Disgrace tries to reverse the process and unapply God's grace. In every situation, Christians are asked to show grace or courteous goodwill. Sometimes I find it's not that hard to be courteous to the person in front of me, even if I disagree with them. But it's not so easy not to speak against them as a group. How hard is it to stand up for someone that most people are against? Like the disciples, we passionately champion what we've heard and believe. What is our job as teachers? Do you think that the only teachers are those who teach in school? I want you to raise your hand if you see someone here that's younger than you. Raise your hand if you see someone here that's older than you. As long as you're on this earth, you're a teacher. Someone's learning by watching what you say or seeing how you act as long as you live. A teacher delivers people from disgrace. Instilling doubt and guilt should be a job left predominantly to people like preachers and other religious leaders. A teacher does spare others from suffering, but models servanthood, standing near, ready to vindicate. Anybody know what vindication means? It means not going after someone or having your say. It literally means to clear someone of blame or suspicion. But everyone wants vindication for themselves and their cause. But who wants it for the person that goes against their agenda? Apparently not even Jesus. Then how is it possible to both teach and be quiet as we walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living? First, the Bible says we must listen as one who is taught. When God wakes you up, God also opens your eyes and your ears, just like the first time they were ever opened, morning by morning. But also morning by morning, someone else is there, ready to rail against you and every other human being, ready to talk about our failings, quote what others say and do wrong. Satan is the original bad-mouthing, liar, pants on fire, accuser who uses his tongue to speak evil. Our second reading and the children's sermon talk about how tongues are designed with purpose. People are like parrots. Like them, we use our tongues to move food around, explore objects, and even our environments. Who remembers when Ralphie from the Christmas Story was triple dog dared to place his tongue on a frozen school flagpole? He found out immediately that even though his tongue was useful for licking, breathing, tasting, swallowing, and speaking, that humans aren't always that smart when it comes to using their tongues. When Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do people say I am?" he knew that only one part of their body could answer, the tongue. As is still the case, Jesus already knew people's thoughts, but found it fascinating to hear their answers. Because when people speak, they choose what comes out. After listening, he tells them not to say anything. Why? Because things were about to get gnarly. On an episode of The Incredible Dr. Paul, does anybody know him? He's a veterinarian. A Labrador chewed on a fishing lure and got three hooks stuck in his mouth. With the one lure, the dog managed to join both sides of his bottom lip together, along with his tongue. Even after the barbs were cut off and the hooks were removed, there was a price to pay for that dog's momentary temptation to use his mouth for self-gratification. Like a dog, sometimes when people open their mouths, they end up with painful, lasting reminders of what happens when one follows the urge to satisfy oneself without thinking. If both dogs and humans always followed their instincts, imagine the heap of trouble. Well, it doesn't take much imagination, does it? Soreness, expensive bills, emergency visits to the doctor. Let's learn a lesson from the Labrador. Finally, we turn to what Jesus says with a modern day twist. Imagine this. I think it's a pretty strong parallel. In the fall of 2020, then President Donald Trump predicts his own defeat in the next election. He talks about returning to the private sector and moving out of the White House. "Watch me. I'm leaving D.C. to reside in Palm Beach," he tells his followers. How would they respond? Probably the same way Jesus' followers did when Jesus spoke of his own suffering, rejection, death, and resurrection. Rather than celebration, victory, establishing a kingdom and moving forward as his followers had planned. Kellyanne Conway, like Peter, would have done whatever she could to keep it from happening, beginning with trying to talk her boss out of moving forward with any such plans. But unlike President Trump, instead of expecting his followers to take control and change his fate, which would have been the human thing to do, Jesus made his followers swear not to interfere. You must let things unfold as they will. Don't speak about how much you wish things were different than they are. Let go of your wish for me to reign as your anointed leader. Don't set your mind on human things, but let God's will be done. Now, my example is not meant to say that Trump is more or less like Jesus, but that then and now people still confuse mortals with divine purpose. There are moral individuals on both sides of the aisle. As disciples and political followers prove time and time again, the agenda of moral mortals doesn't always match divine purpose. Disciples and followers always believe their candidate is best. Only their candidate is trustworthy and will uphold what's right. They become followers exactly because they see something that they recognize as God's appointment and God's anointing. Every Jesus follower then and now wanted to side with the person they felt certain God had empowered to carry out a plan for their nation, whether it was Israel or America. And our way of thinking is exactly the same as what possessed the disciples. You have to win. Do whatever it takes. Don't talk about defeat or not carrying out the agenda through to the end. Come on. What are you saying? We want you to remain in power till every objective is met, every goal is reached. We don't want to hear it. Don't say any more, Jesus. Wait, wasn't that Jesus' line? Don't say any more? Kind of makes you wonder what Jesus was trying to say. Perhaps Jesus was trying to say something like this. It's not that simple, y'all. Stop thinking of people, including me, in such simple, defined terms. Labeling an individual as one thing or another, even when you imagine something good, makes them one-dimensional. There's much more to God's plan than you see. Putting individuals in certain groups and assigning them specific agendas is an attempt at domestication. Building a pigeonhole and identifying them with a metal band on their legs. How many people must we try to control by knowing their whereabouts, tracking their movements, and limiting their freedoms? You see, there's always two sides to every argument. We don't define what's good or what's right. Even the best leaders cannot legislate or mandate God's chosen way of being in the world and serving divine purpose, because we don't have the capacity to give as God does. But we're constantly being open to give more generously, to live more freely, to love unexpectedly and undeservedly. The psalmist said, "Turn again to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt well with you." Like Dr. Pold, God has cut the barbs off the hooks. He's bent Satan's weapons so they can't penetrate our flesh as easily. Like the lab, we may still suffer, but hopefully we'll learn who to trust. The ones who care for us, and hopefully we'll get help when we ourselves get in trouble. God is a gracious, suffering model of sacrifice. God became human to teach, to serve, and to doctor us. And like Dr. Pohl, God has an excellent knowledge of those in his care. And like Dr. Pohl, his techniques may seem crude and brutal, but they always have healing as their goal. Because humans are creatures in need. And as such, surrender is against our nature. But we must either surrender or submit if we're to receive the intervention needed. So I ask, is there any part of you that needs to surrender or to submit? Is there something to deny or lose that you currently hold on to? Maybe you could let go of absolute certainty that you're right. Perhaps you might simply stop asserting that someone else is wrong. listen to Jesus say, "If you refuse, what will it profit you? Indeed, what can you give in return for your life?" What does it mean to live like Jesus, to give of yourself so others might live? Let us pray. Dear Lord, your grace is generous, free, unexpected, and undeserved. Help us surrender fully so we can receive the help we need and the good gifts you offer. Free us from oversimplifying or overcomplicating people and information. May our truth not go against your will, cause others to stray or suffer. Teach us all we need to know to use our tongues and freedom wisely, according to your divine purpose. In your holy name we pray.
great song selections. Thank you. Let's profess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed found there in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
May children and heirs of God's promise repay for the church, the world, and all in need. Revealing God, you've made yourself known in so many ways through bread and wine, water and word. Continue to nurture your church so it's a place where your presence is experienced and shared. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creating God, you bring life into being and call it good. Bring new creation to lands devastated by tornadoes, hurricanes, floods, fires, and other disasters. Help us redefine natural disasters by taking responsibility as appropriate. Restore insufficiency, curb excess. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Protecting God, we desire that all people live in peace and safety. Provide for all who are in danger. Strengthen first responders and long-term therapists to help meet the complex needs of others. Provide care and compassion as they face trauma themselves. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Transforming God, you announce release to the captives and freedom to the oppressed. Break chains of discrimination and injustice. Amplify voices that go unheard and inspire us to advocate for those who are overlooked. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Forming God, you gather this community together. Thank you for the church's relationship with Lake Tobias, other friends and partners. Shape our communal life, that in our prayer, praise, and worship, we honor you and encourage one another. Keep our disagreements civil and increase our joy in working together. Be with those who were unable to join us today. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Redeeming God, you accompany your people through every stage of life. We give you thanks for the saints, especially Peg Kissinger, Catherine Kiefer, and Lynn Wells, who now rest in your embrace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these spoken prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. You have to turn in all directions to do that today. Thank you. All right, we'll go ahead and say the offertory verse. Let the vineyards be fruitful. Let's use our tongues and voices to pray the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,
the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
I would ask, does anybody know Johnny Appleseed? Oh, you do? Okay. Well, I'm going to teach you something. It's going to be our closing song. It's also going to be our grace before we eat. It's something that our kids learned at camp, and then we sang it all the time. It goes, oh, the Lord's been good to me, and so I thank the Lord for giving me the things I need, like the sun and the rain and the apple seed. The Lord's been good to me. Dot, you want to come up here and help me sing it? And then you guys got to sing it. We all got to sing it. All God's children got a voice. I don't know if that's going to happen, but yeah, we're going to sing together. Ready? Oh, the Lord's been good to me, and so I thank the Lord for giving me the things I need, like the sun and the rain and the apple seed. The Lord's been good to me. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Now we have a certain direction that the food lines to go in. The last two tables are the food. The middle of those two stay clear for the servers. You start at this basket here that looks like it's got silverware in it, and then travel your way around. There's thank you again for bringing side dishes. The main dishes will be out there somewhere, I'm sure. And then there's ice cream and toppings for afterward. God bless you all. Thanks for coming.